Welcome back to the Growing Band Director podcast. This is episode number 159. And today we're discussing musical success for your students and how score study can help this happen. You know, we live in this world of always trying to catch up as band directors, and I'm right there with you. There's so many times that we find music that we think is a good program and we work on it with our kids, and we don't actually get the time in our schedule to actually study the scores. You know, I've been there. We've all been there. I just want to promote how important it is, for many different reasons we'll talk about, to find times as much as you can to really prepare your scores in the most in-depth way as possible, because it does two things for you. One, most importantly, it gets you really excited about the music, because when you bring out all these amazing things that are within these masterworks that you are working on with your students. Maybe masterwork is a strong word for some of them, but these pieces you've chosen as a curriculum, once you take this information in and you realize what's really happening, it gets you excited as a performer. And then as a performer, you get to then teach your students, okay, this is kind of what's happening and why we're going to do this decision or that decision, and why you can make different choices. I just find that it brings the music alive. And you know why things are, and students perform so much better when they're understanding these things. So like, there's multiple levels of score study, right? So let's talk about the first one. When you are choosing a program for your students, the first level of score study has to be, all right, what is required of this band? Who's going to perform this? And is this my band? Can this work for my band? Is this too hard? Is this too easy? Does this fit all of the humans that are in there? Is it kind of fit that middle, what is it, 80%, right? Your top 10%, it might be a little on the easy side. And for your bottom 10%, it might be a little on the hard side, but it's got to fit that mean right there in the middle. So once you've chosen that music and you get the copies and you pass it out and you know that, okay, this is the right fit. And then you make strategies about like, okay, how am I going to get my students to perform this? And whether that be through companion guides or other supplemental materials, or you just have to have your A game on to know like, okay, how do I get these students to actually play this, right? So one thing that we talk about a lot on the podcast is studying recordings. You know, some people subscribe to the don't listen to recordings, make your musical decisions as a conductor based on the score rather than the recordings. I understand that mode. I do not live in that world. I live in the world of let's listen to some recordings and what do they do as performers that we want to add? And I'll have some things to share with you on that. So know that these works that you're working on with your students are flexible. They're deep, hopefully, and there's things in here that you can bring out to your students. So once you get going on this music, preferably before, but even in the middle of the preparation season, it's totally important to try to get 5 minutes at a time, 15 minutes at a time, whatever it is, to get some understanding of what's happening in the actual scores and why the music works so well and what you can do. So again, I know we've all learned how to study scores. So there's some things I might tell you that will be new to you, but hopefully you get something out of this. It's just so, so important. And the first piece we're going to look at is a grade 2 by Aaron Copland, transcribed for band by Merlin Patterson, called Down a Country Lane. So the first thing when I dove into this piece, I'm doing it with a band. And the first thing to know is that the percussion is almost non-existent. There's an optional vibraphone part. So right away, your score study should say, is this a band? Can I do this with a band? And so many times I have not done this with a band because I had percussionists in the room. And yes, there's a vibraphone part and you could have four kids play that on a marimba, on a bunch of marimbas and vibraphones, and that would be totally doable. There is a string bass part. Maybe you put that on a marimba, or maybe you find some other alternative things. But so often people would say, well, I'm not going to do this piece because of my schedule setup. And that's, I think that's smart. If you have nine percussionists who are playing grade two music, you don't want to sit them down while you try to work on Copeland. It's like impossible. So in my schedule, I have percussion separate. So this is a chance for me to do it and do it well. So first of all, when you're looking at the score study, what one thing I like to do, you know, we talk about this concept of ringing chords, trying to play in tune in pure temperament. If you listen back, we've done some episodes with the harmony director and the some great teachers and all this. But one thing that I really do is you sit down and you like figure out the harmony, like what's happening in each section. So in Down a Country Lane, it's in F, but it kind of starts and ends these sections on B flat. And there's lots of different things that it does. But for me, I'll like take each harmony and then I like writing ones and threes and fives next to sort of each half note or each quarter note. So if we had to sit in like tune a certain chord, I have an idea right away. Okay, who's the third? And on that third, they're going to have to bring it down to play it in tune, or who's the fifth so they can raise it up a little bit, right? Just being aware of it. Or maybe you have a drone or like a keyboard, at the very least like a piano. And then you can like play roots or roots and fifths to help them tune these chords. So on Down a Country Lane, you know, there's this first phrase that happens and it's gorgeous. And whether you know this piece or not, it doesn't really matter. These are all things that are going to apply to a lot of different pieces. The second time he does the melody, what I notice is that it's basically the same thing, only he's added some more instruments, including trumpet cup mutes, which is really cool. So if you're going to do this piece, use the cup mutes. But he has the bass voices just sustain this low F, like this pedal F for the entire, what is it, nine measures. And it's amazing because Down a Country Lane originally was written by Aaron Copland for Time Life magazine. They were asking a master composer to write a beginning piano piece. So this is what it was written for, a piano, and then it was done for band. So this picture of when you think of a country lane, like for me, it's like the middle of the summer and it's just like beautiful and breezy. And, you know, to me, there's a sense of longing and nostalgia with that. So when we play letter A to B, this low F just kind of sits there the entire time. And what that does is, even though the F's there, there's all these other chords that are happening above. You know, they're not complicated chords. What is it, like B flat, some G minor, a little bit of C. You know, it's just kind of going on and on, but this F's always there. So when you get to the end of the phrase and it lands on an actual F chord in the upper parts, it's like not only is it a finalizing sound, but Copeland used that F the whole time. So it gives you the sense of nostalgia, the sense of like, well, that was always there. Like maybe we never left home, even though we kind of went on these journeys with different harmonies. So I just love that part. One other thing that's great about this piece, it goes from one flat to four flats and then back to one flat, but it doesn't go to A flat major, it goes to F minor. So, you know, knowing that, okay, F is still the root, but now we're on the parallel minor that goes along with that. You know, you just treat it differently. You have to tune it differently. And just being aware of that is a really, really big deal. And as the end of the piece comes, it's just this glorious chance to make music. And when you listen to some recordings, you'll notice you really need a clarinet choir to do this piece well. Oh yeah, you really need a lot of things, but the clarinets to me are some kind of the center of this. Flute kind of lives in that world too, low flute especially. Let's see, there was something else I wanted to say about this for sure. Oh yeah. So in my school, we're lucky enough. We have like all the clarinets. We have an E flat clarinet and obviously all the B flats clarinets. And we have an alto clarinet and the kids, we have bass clarinets, of course. And then we have like E flat contra and B flat contra. We've just been able to acquire those through the years and they work well. So when I'm using this, it's actually mainly with a freshman band, but we're using E flat alto clarinet and everybody's laughing and driving off the road right now. And then we're also using like the contra bass clarinet. But guess what? This band I'm using doesn't have any tubas, which is super sad. But when you add that contra bass clarinet along with the rest of the bass voices, it helps give that lowest octave. And now, is it as resonant or sonorous as if you had four tubas back there? Well, maybe not. But the students that I have, we're really working on creating a calm and smooth sound and stretching our notes. So they have these quarter notes that kind of just move through and they're all slurred. But what we do is we go really slow and try to stretch the notes as much as possible. So that's something that we've been learning here, and we'll do some imagery work and all that. What do they hear when they listen to the piece? What do they visualize, and try to bring that up when they perform it. So it's a great piece for us, and that's what the score study's done for me on that piece. And one of the ways that we've really worked on developing the tone of Down a Country Lane is obviously through the pyramid of sound. And there's so many different exercises you can do with that, right? We all know a lot of those, and if you don't, you should check out some. There's you can really make your band dark sounding and sonorous. The best that you can. But another thing about that piece to prepare them for playing it well was we took, okay, concert F might sound great, but what about the second note of the scale? What about the third note of the scale? So really trying to improve the tone of every single note of the major scale, or at least the first four or five notes, so that when they move around in the piece, they have a concept of this. And I found out through doing this that the metronome goes down to 30. And that's beautiful. So trying to play something that slow and stretched out really helps develop them, I found in that piece. Okay, next piece I want to look at is Cenotaph by Jack Stamp. This is a grade 3.5. It's a super cool piece. A cenotaph is a statue or monument to someone who is not buried there. So the Lincoln Memorial and Washington Monuments are familiar examples of this. This is a grade 3.5 piece, and it sounds harder. It is a 3.5, but if it fits your band right, it works. So you need six percussionists. You could do it with more for sure, but you need at least six. And it's pretty heavy on percussion, but it's pretty repetitive. So they don't have to be the world's most stellar percussionist, but they have to be able to play in a groove together really well. The opening of the piece is this canon that uses the rhythm one, two, three, four, and three. And that's going to come up later in the piece. But one reason I could do this is because it starts with just trumpets up together on high unison F sharp. So if you have a trumpet section that can do that and can do it well or grow into it, and there's nothing else happening during that time, then you can do the piece, or could potentially do the piece. For me, that's a section that works really well, and it works well for my percussion section too.
Thank you.
What's great about Cenotaph is it is like one of these pieces that is an ode to things like George Washington Bridge, where there's polytonal chords happening, you know, one chord on top and another chord on bottom, or two chords stacked on top of each other. And it's so cool. Like, you got to go in and figure out what's the harmony here. Like, what's actually going on. And this piece is actually an open key. So it builds it like through the opening of this. And then, you know, when you get to measure 20, and again, this, there's a tempo change, but it's layered really, really well. So each part, you know, there's a vibe part, a bell part, a chime part, triangle, sleigh bells, and timpani. You know, it's not complicated. It's very repetitive, but they have to just learn one pattern that grows on top of each other. The woodwind part seems really crazy, but it's not. If you actually look at it, and this happens in a lot of pieces, it's a 7-beat rhythm. And in this case, it goes 1, 2, 3, 4, and. Whoops, I said that wrong. 1, 2, 3, 4, and. Or maybe I said it right. It's a 7-beat rhythm that repeats in 4-4. So even though it doesn't look repetitive, it is. And the minute I told my students that, they went, oh. And they could just play it instantly. It was really, really awesome. So then, you know, the other horn parts here are pretty cool, but there's a part as it goes through that isn't just in C minor for a while. It is like this, these stacked poly chords. So as long as I tell the students that, you know, they think that's really, really cool. And it requires that, you know, they know, okay, in these four bars, who am I listening to? Right now, let's write the word trumpet here, because we got to stay underneath the trumpets. Or over here, let's stay underneath the trombones. Or let's get into the sound of the tubas, right? You have to kind of tell your kids that, or what's happening. And then, you know, the biggest thing I notice people don't do is like, they don't, a lot of people don't write out the harmonies. Like, what's the chord? Like, is this a B? How do you make it sound good if you don't know that it's a B flat major chord? Or if you don't know it's an F major chord? Or if you look at it and you're like, whoa, that's actually not a simple chord. Sit at the piano and do the best you can, or ask some friends. You know, the end of this piece ends in G flat. Doesn't start there, but it ends in G flat. But again, it's an open key, so all the accidentals are written out. You know, there's some tricky things to this for sure, but students are all about a piece like this because they get to learn all these brand new things. And for my kids, it's working really well. We've had like 5 rehearsals and they can almost play the whole piece already. And it's great. It's a really short piece, but so it works well if you want to do a concert with maybe 4 pieces. You know, sometimes you do concerts with even more than that. For me, it's usually 3 or 4. So again, this is like a contemporary piece of music that's playable as long as you have, you know, a kind of a couple of the key ingredients. I have to say, one of the hardest keys to play well in to me for band is D flat concert. That's D flat. So on a hymn song of Philip Bliss, so many of you have performed this. It is a piece that doesn't get played quite as much. There's so many things about this. For me, the number one thing is the key signature. Having kids play in D flat. Like, we need more pieces in that key. Now, again, one of my friends said, why don't they write it in E flat? Like, that would have been amazing. Maybe a little more playable. But the story I heard from Tony, thank you, Tony, is that David Holsinger wanted the note for the high note for trumpet 1 to be a G and no higher. So if it's in D flat, that puts the trumpets on E flat, and the highest part had third on the trumpet 1. So that's why it went in that key. I thought that was pretty cool. So first of all, like, what is the hymn song? What is the Philip Bliss hymn song? So you want to do that research, about like, what is the background behind this? Like, why did he write it? And in this case, it's a tune called It Is Well With My Soul. And there's a great history behind that we're not going to get into, but you know, the lyrics, for example, on the part of this where they have just the 3 notes in a row that are quarter notes, like that's the words, it is well with my soul. You know, there's these things that you can work into for sure. So low woodwinds, if you have a saxophone section and you really want to work on playing low and soft, and the clarinets low, probably a little bit louder. That's the easier part here, but there's pinkies everywhere for both instruments. It's such a fantastic piece of music. There's a horn solo that starts after the introduction. So the horn player should be strong. I mean, it's cued in other instruments too, but like the French horn is really where it's at here. It's a piece to work on phrasing, you know, like you get to think about, okay, not 1,000 notes, but like, when do we breathe? When do we not breathe? How do we make this really musical? Got to force your students to do that for sure. And tuning here. So like we warm up in D flat every day. And guess what? The first piece is on a hymn song and fill of Bliss. We just got to get that D flat sonority happening in our program. So whether it's through a harmony director or drones or whatever else you can do, just getting this comfortable for students is really, really important. You know, a big thing is like, okay, at each point, who has the melody? Who doesn't have the melody? Like we have to know all the time, who are we listening to? Where do we go through? So this melody passes through a lot of the brass during the opening of this. And there's a really easy to overplay that melody. So people, you can need to be aware of it. I mean, if you have a score handy at measure 9, you got to play underneath the horn. At measure 17, you got to play underneath the horn and trombone 1. And then at measure, 21? You got to play underneath trombone 1 and trumpet 1. So, you know, there's just lots of things happening. When it comes to tuning all these chords, like, okay, like for young kids, here's what my suggestion. If you get them to play like the one chord in tune, like they know when they have the third and they know when they have the fifth and the kind of what to do on that. And if you don't know, again, go back and look at our episode with the Carmel band directors and the Yamaha harmony director. And you can hear a little bit more about that, but just find where those chords are. Like where is the D flat major chord prevalent? Where's just a one chord, like right at the beginning or ends of phrases, and just work on tuning those. Don't work on tuning all of it. Just work on tuning that. And it makes it much more attainable. A couple other things I'll do is like when the music repeats, like literally it's happened already. So what are we going to do differently? And what are we going to do the same? You know, how do you interpret that differently? We're humans. You want to take this body of music that's on the paper and bring it to life. One of the things I'll do is I'll tell students like, okay, there's a rallentando in this measure and I'm going to conduct it like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1. And I'll even show them what it's going to look like. And I'll have them conducted too. So it really allows the music to happen. So many times there's like a rallentando or retard and we don't do it. You know, that's a huge part of the music. And kids can love ballads, but you have to make it really relevant to them by really showing your passion for it and all that. So it's just fantastic music. You know, like, for example, there's a brass thing at 42. They have to come in and play much faster than the rest of the pieces. Well, so what I told my students is like, okay, trumpets, trombones, and euphonium. I think that's who has it. Yeah, when we get to measure 42, it's going to go much faster. Memorize that first measure. Just look at it right now. Okay, so they've memorized it. So look up for those first four notes. And then once we're good, then you can look down. And we've taught them to look up every few measures already. But like right there, let's look up so we start together. You know, like tenor sax enters on like the ninth of a minor chord. So it's like this crunchy little thing. You tell them that, hey, this note is going to feel weird because it's a half step away from a chord tone. All right. That's not hard to figure out. You just kind of look at the chord and go, oh, that's what that is. Cool. So then the student can perform it a little better. That's just like a great example of like the tenor sax when they come in on that D. Like, it's not hard to do, but if they know it sounds weird, they're going to back off because they're not confident humans. If you can teach them to play out through something like that, especially as Terry White says, if it's the lower note of a crunchy chord or crunchy interval, that's the word I'm looking for, then they have to play it out even more. And that gives them the confidence. And guess what? They're growing as humans. They're growing as humans. You know, later in this piece, it says broaden greatly. Well, that means slow down a lot. And I have a point. So here's measure 55, where it's like everybody has these block chords and it's getting huge, but there's this great counter line that goes 2E and a 3. In my wind ensemble who's playing this right now, it's a small group. It's like 35 players. On this tune, I have one alto player. Now it's covered other places for most things, but that one measure, there's not enough in that on those 16th notes. So guess what? I just go, wait a minute, I have an amazing horn player right next to that alto player. Why don't I just have her play those five notes? So it's like kind of on the spot arranging. I write it out if I have to, or just kind of have her look over, transpose it and learn it and play it. You know, it just gives the students this flexibility to like really bring the music alive. And, you know, as my friend Trey Blanco at Butler University says, you know, soft is where it's at. This piece, you get to really work on strong, but also really soft and just being okay with playing as soft as possible. Now, your band might not be able to play super soft. You might be able to play like pretty soft. That's okay. You're working on playing as soft as you can with a good sound. Keep in mind, at least this is my opinion, clarinets, when they're down below the staff, because we know the clarinets are soft down low, they can easily play soft. They have to play a little bit louder. And the saxophones have to really work on playing soft. And that works. The way I'm conducting the end is, if everybody doesn't know, it's just a whole note. And at the very end, the timpani comes in, but there's moving eighth notes and you want to slow down a lot. So I'm literally just conducting all of the eighth notes. I taught my students that and it brought together really, really well. So, you know, this is a piece that has so much intrinsic value to it. And I've talked to a lot of people and, you know, a lot of people don't play it anymore. So honestly, that is Roman numerals and I can't read what year that is. Is it 1999? Maybe. 89. I probably should have prepared that, but you know, it's a great piece of music and there is percussion in it for sure, but you know, it has to be the right place. So you're not chasing every single note. I've done this with all levels of students from grade 2.5 all the way up through grade 5 bands. And it's just a fantastic piece of music.
Thank you.
particular piece we're doing is the Douglas Wagner arrangement of Morton Gould's masterpiece,
American Salute.
Some of us may know it. If you don't know it, check it out. The original, check the original out. But if your band is not a grade five band, you won't be able to play it. It's based on When Johnny Comes Marching Home, or as all of us know, The Ants Go Marching Two by Two. This is a grade 3.5 arrangement. So we're doing it because it's going to fit my kids really, really well. Kids love it, but I think I've sold it pretty well. To be honest, here's why I remember to do it. I had a day off. I'm a parent and I have two kids. And for some reason, like 6 months ago, I was home and my kids weren't home. So I was watching TV, right? So what comes on that I have to watch every time I see Die Hard 3, I have to watch it. It's just the way I own it and I never turn on the DVD, but when it's on TV, I have to watch it. So anyway, in the middle of it, all this, you know, the theme of like the bad guys is When Johnny Comes Marching Home. So I heard it and then I went, oh my gosh, I have some amazing brass players. We should do this piece. So I listened to the original and then I went, okay, that's not going to happen. Maybe I'm wrong. But then I saw that there was the arrangement and it's just perfect. So fits my kids really well. And it's going to be a great opener for a piece that a lot of people don't play, but the Douglas Wagner arrangement makes it fit my band and a lot of other bands. So, you know, first thing I did was say, okay, what's Johnny Comes Marching Home? So let's sing it, or at least say it. So we all did that. We did the When Johnny Comes Marching Home again, hurrah, hurrah. We did like the whole melody. But guess what? When people play this, they accent the hurrah, ta-ta, ta-ta. That's not written in. It's just part of it. So when we sang it, I then said, okay, whenever you have this melody, accent those two notes. So we sang the hurrah, hurrah, and then they wrote it in. So guess what? I fixed it on the whole piece just by giving them that concept. You know, there's moments where it has to stay loud on this piece where it's like, it doesn't stay loud, but it's easy for the kids to get softer. Like, no, I insist that it stays loud because that's what's written on the paper. And that's what the piece is supposed to be. So you have to kind of like stick to your guns as to like, no, this is not supposed to get softer. I know it gets lower, but let's work really hard. And kids really, really dig that. What's the difference between all accented? But in this piece, there's a lot of things that goes where it has 3/8 notes. It's in 6/8 and the two are slurred. Well, every single time you should accent the first note. Dieta, 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 dieta. So literally they went through the entire piece and just wrote in an accent on every single one just to get to a point where they were always doing it. There was one other thing that I had them do. Anytime they have a chromatic triplet, it goes like ba-da-da-dum or ba-da-da-dum, right? It happens a lot in the bass line in a couple different variations. If it goes up, crescendo. If it goes down, decrescendo. Like some really simple things that if you had your horn and you were playing in a community band and you were playing this piece, what would you play? How would you play it? And then all you got to do is say, okay, I would play it like that. Kids do that. Even if it's not written on the paper, and it just takes your group to a whole other level. So what I did is I went through with the students and told them, okay, this is 7 variations. It's the same tune 7 times. But all I had to do was like go through, listen, look at the score and figure out, oh, this is the tune again. All right, here's variation 2 or A2, as I would call it. You know, if there's some of these back and forth rhythms, I'll just rehearse it like whisper counting. For us, that's the, you know, whatever I need to do to make that happen. So variation 1 is pretty standard and that works really well. Okay, variation 2, what changes? Like, why is it different? You know, the French horns have this like pass back and forth. Well, right, kids aren't going to count. They're going to try to play it together. So just telling them, this is not together. You're on 2, you're on 1. You know, things like that. It goes further than you think. The third variation, of course, all the lows get the melody. Well, this is fantastic. But guess what? It's all like pretty and soft. And then they have to come in like bulls in a china closet. So like I had them write the word rude at the beginning of that. If you have a score, it's measure 81. And they come in like just super strong. And they're ready for it because they've been resting for a little bit. And they've already have those accents written in. Ta-ta, ta-ta. But what's cool here is the woodwinds have the counter line. So it's like, or the answer. So the lows go, ba-ba-ba-da-bum-ba-ti-ba-da-ba-da. And the woodwinds go, ba-ba, ba-ba, ba-ba. Well, the woodwinds have to accent those counter line, the answers too. You know, so it's just like musical interpretation stuff. When you choose a piece that you don't have to chase every note and rhythm, you get to do this stuff. And this is what happens when you program at the right level or potentially a little under where you think, and then you can really get into the music of it. Okay, so the fourth variation for the woodwinds is maniacal. I mean, for this grade level, they have to work on it a lot, especially the clarinet section. It's kind of a feature on them, but I have students who I know will work on it and they're doing fine on it. The fifth variation to me is the trickiest because it goes into 4-4 and there's a lot of back and forth and interplay, but the kids love it. You know, one thing I've been doing more recently is it's like, okay, if we're newer on a piece, I know some have practiced, but some have not practiced. Well, they can get 40 seconds of practice right now. So I'll say, okay, we're about to read the next 30 measures. Take 45 seconds and just practice what you need to. And it's amazing how when you start and you go to play it, so many things have improved because they've literally just practiced it right then. Now, if your culture is in a place where you can do that, where you can start the band, you can give them a chance to practice and then come back and bring them back, and you can do that seamlessly, it works. If you don't have that culture or they're not old enough to do that, it doesn't work. But that is a fantastic thing that I found. You know, I noticed in this variation, the fifth variation, it's in C minor, but in the second half, it goes up the whole step to D minor. Like, I wouldn't know that unless I actually sat and looked at the score. You know, how many times if you stopped and somebody said, what key is the band playing in? You'd be like, no idea, right? So just taking it and writing D little M with an exclamation point, oh, it goes up a step. You might not use that, but you also might use it. I love that. That's probably my favorite variation. The sixth one is very regal and it's a spread out melody. So I think that's called augmentation. So when you take a melody and just like make it longer. So again, you just tell kids that, oh, that's the same melody, but it's twice as long. Oh, that's so cool. You know, this is really cool. Oh, now you get to play it with a straight mute. I had them write the word regal, you know. The next variation, I had them go like, oh, this is light. This is light now. And then I was listening to part of this and it's like, what? I'm actually going to skip ahead to the final variation. It's a measure 194. Like, why does this sound so weird? Like the melody on top is just this D minor melody, but like, why does it sound so like augmented and weird? It's because the chords under the band are going D major, B flat major, D flat, B flat, like back and forth. And it gives us this really uneasy, settled sound, like this forward motion happening. Again, it's not complicated. I mean, some pieces are really hard to analyze. Stuff I'm looking at, like if you're not sure about how to analyze a piece and you have a hard time with transpositions, just look at the low brass parts. The low brass parts don't transpose. So a lot of times you can find the harmony just by looking at the low brass parts if the piece is simple enough. And the piece gets so soft. Oh, guess what? When it gets to piano, play soft. Actually play soft. Like don't just say, oh, that's pretty good. No. Your band can always play softer. If you don't think it's soft enough, don't ask them. It's not soft enough. So work on playing it softer. Because guess what? When you play really soft, you don't have to play as loud. And they sound great. Like, how many bands have you ever heard where you say, when they just didn't play loud enough, they never played loud enough? Like, that is extremely rare. But when you play soft, right, then that brings the whole palette down and everything up. So, you know, the end of this piece is really strong. Why does it sound strong? It's in unison. Ba-da-ba-bum, ba-bum. Like, great. That's obvious, you know, but things like that, marking it unison, exclamation point, you know, or to be fair, octaves, right? So things like that. When you're in harmony, play a little louder. When you're in unison or octaves, play a little softer, right? These are things that, like, we've all learned. As players, just put yourself in each one of your students' positions. Go, okay, if I were playing this third trumpet part, even if I'm not a trumpet player, okay, like how would I play this on my instrument? What would I do musically to make it really work? How would I as a professional, how would I play that part? And you ask yourself that and just give your kids those cheat codes, those hints of all the things you've learned over the years, man, it just brings your band to a whole new level. So, you know, I totally get there's seasons where we do not quote unquote need to score study. You know, if you're doing party rock anthem, maybe you don't need to score study. It depends on where you're at, right? But like you might take a chord and go, wait a minute, why can't I hear the third of this chord? It just sounds like, why does it sound out of balance? And then you look at it, only the third clarinet as the major third. Maybe you only have one third clarinet. Maybe you don't have any third clarinets. And then you go, oh, there's no major third anywhere, right? The composer put it in one, but for us, it doesn't work. You know, just like really, really basic stuff. like that. Or maybe it's not so basic, but things that you notice as you sort of just pry into the scores a little bit helps you bring it alive. And for me, what it's done is when I've done score study, I'm excited because I'm excited about the music. And then when I'm excited about the music, don't you think my students have a better shot of being excited about the music too? So I hope this has been helpful. I know I chose sort of four random pieces. These are not for the same band and they are not on the same program, but they're just, they have a ton of things in them that I thought was really valuable. So do your score study, reach out for help. If you need help for anything from mentors, join our Facebook group, go to thegrowingbanddirector.com, buy a poster, you know, whatever you want to do. Keep on keeping on. Thanks for doing what you do.
We sincerely appreciate you taking your valuable time and listening to the Growing Band Director podcast. Your students are very lucky to have a band director like you. If you have any suggestions for episode topics or think you have an area of expertise to share on a show with us, please reach out. If you enjoyed this episode, don't forget to subscribe. And if you want to help spread the word, please give us a 5-star review and tell your band director friends to subscribe as well. We're available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, our YouTube channel, and wherever you listen to podcasts. Thanks for listening to The Growing Band Director. See you next week.